The year was 1992, and it was my final year of high school. And as the school year ended, we had to put our university preferences into the computer for next year. During high school, I was very into music. I played the violin, and I was hoping to get into a Bachelor of Music degree at university. So I put down, in all my university preferences, I put down all music courses, all except for the last preference. For the last preference, just as a bit of a joke in front of my friends, I put down a Bachelor of Education in Early Childhood Teaching, kindergarten teaching. I turned to my friends and said, "Look, guys, I might get into kindergarten teaching." Such was my confidence that I would get into music. Well, the next year rolled around and the university placements came out, and you guessed it, I got a placement in a Bachelor of Education in Early Childhood Development, kindergarten teaching. Well, I was devastated. All my dreams had been dashed. I felt like I had missed out. I realize that for some of you here tonight, you might feel exactly like that. You're in that critical decade from 18 to 30-ish, where you have to make a whole heap of life-defining decisions. Decisions like, what sort of career do I want? Should I get married? Whom should I marry? Should I go out with that particular person on a date? Should I go out on that particular person on a date? What should I be doing with the rest of my life, and where and with whom should I be doing it? And when it comes to all of these questions, I think, you know, what we tend to ask is, God, do you have a will for my life? And if you do, how do I discover it? So tonight, I want to look at the topic of discovering God's will for your life. And I want to basically answer two questions. Does God have a will for my life? And can I miss out on His will? So does God have a will or a plan for your life? And can you miss out on that plan, on that will? And to answer that question, I think what the Bible does is it speaks about the will of God in three ways. First, the Bible speaks about the sovereign will of God. In Ephesians 1, in verse 11, Paul says this, "In Him we've obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of Him who works all things according to the counsel of His will." How many things does God work? He works all things, not just some things, all things according to the counsel of His will, according to His plan. So this verse is teaching us that God has an all-inclusive plan that He is working out in human history. Now, this is not only the teaching of Paul. We also find over in the Old Testament, in Isaiah 46, verses 9 and 10, God says this, "I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose." There it is again. God declares the end from the beginning. His counsel or His plan will stand. He really will accomplish His purpose. You see, the Bible teaches that God really is God, meaning that He really is the one who is sitting on the throne over the universe. And there is nothing that happens apart from His sovereign will. God is that big. He is God. Well, you might ask, well, if God is so sovereign and nothing happens that He does not intend to happen, then God must be responsible for sin and suffering. If God is sovereign and He's the author of human history, Timon, then He must be the author of sin and suffering. Well, I know why you would think that, but the Bible just unequivocally affirms that God is not the author of sin and suffering. The Bible affirms that God is good. James says, when one is tempted, one should not say that God is tempting me, because God cannot tempt anyone, neither can He be tempted by evil. Rather, this is the amazing thing about God. God is that big that He allows free agents to make sinful choices, but their sinful choices are still part of His plan. So He allowed Satan to rebel against Him and take one third of the angels. He allowed Adam and Eve to sin against Him. But God is that big that these sinful choices of free agents did not happen outside of the Council of Israel, but rather were still part of his plan. They were part of his sovereign will. They happened because he had determined that they would happen. Now, probably the greatest example of the tension in the Bible between the sovereignty of God and human responsibility is actually found in the crucifixion of Jesus. In 2 Peter 2, Acts 2, verse 23, Peter is speaking about Jesus and he says this. Look at this. This is really interesting. He says, "This Jesus was delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God." So the crucifixion of Jesus was part of the definite plan of God. Jesus was the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world. God had a plan before the foundation of the world to send Jesus as his Redeemer. But Peter also says this, "This Jesus, who was delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men." So Peter is clearly saying that the crucifixion of Jesus was a part of God's sovereign will, and yet he is holding the men of Israel responsible for it. The Jews did it. So God willed it, and yet he's not responsible for it. The men of Israel were. So God is that big that even the sinful choices of free agents, the sinful choices of people who make those choices by the freedom of their own will, even those choices are under his control and part of his sovereign will or plan. See, it's a little bit like this. Now, who loves watching a good movie? I love watching a good movie. And as you're watching a movie, the thing I love about movies is you watch a movie and you're watching all the characters in the movie interrelate with one another, and they have freedom of will. As you're watching the movie, they're making the choices that they make. But even though as you're watching the movie and you're enjoying them make choices before you on the screen, even though you're watching the movie, everything in the movie has already been written. The script has already been written. And in the same way, even though we make free choices, the story has already been written. God is the author of human history, and the story will turn out the way that God has determined by his sovereign will. Now I know this could be a point of stumbling for many of you, but rather than this be a point of stumbling, the fact that God has a sovereign will is actually supposed to be a source of great comfort. You see, the truth that God is on the throne of the universe and he's working all things according to his sovereign will should be a source of great comfort. As Paul says in Romans 8:28, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good." How many things? All things work together for good. You see, because we know that God is sovereign and he's working all the difficulties in our lives for our good, this should be a great source of comfort, even though those things may not be good. The killing of Jesus, this was not good. This was the most horrific event ever in human history. And yet God is that great that he can take evil events, and even though he doesn't like them, he can use them as part of his plan for his good purposes. Now, not only is God's sovereign will supposed to be a source of great comfort, it's actually supposed to be a source of great humility. You see, as Westerners living in the 21st century, we all like to believe that we are the captains of our soul, that we are the masters of our own destiny. As Tim Keller states, we've all bought into the life control myth. We tend to think that our lives are under our control. And like Disney tells us, we can dream our own dreams if we just believe upon a star or something like that. But this is not the case. I hate to tell your generation, Disney lied. God is the king of the universe. It is under his control. And this should humble us, as James says. Instead of saying, "Today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a town and we will trade and we'll make a profit," instead of making proud plans, every single one of us should say this: "If the Lord wills, we will do this and we will do that." Because it's only by the sovereign will of God that anything happens in our lives. He is the king. We are his servants. So does God have a plan, a sovereign will for your life? Yes, it's a sovereign will for your life. He has a sovereign will for everything that happens in the universe, and this includes your life. Well, can you miss out on that plan? No. No one in this room will miss out on God's sovereign will for their life. As David said in Psalm 139, verse 16, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. So David is saying that God in his sovereignty has written the story of our lives. No one in this room will miss out on God's sovereign will. God's sovereign will be done in every person's life. Even the most ardent atheist, God's will be done. As Paul says in Romans 11, verse 36, for from him and through him and to him are how many things? All things. To him be glory forever. Amen. Now, before you accuse me of ascribing to some form of fatalism or teaching that we are all robots or puppets on a string, I call this aspect of God's will his sovereign will for a reason. I called it that because even though the Bible teaches that God is king, that he is sovereign, and that he's working all things according to his sovereign plan, you and I don't know what his sovereign will is. It is hidden from us. God is transcendent, meaning that he transcends time and space as we know it. And even though you and I can find comfort from his sovereign will and should be humbled by the fact that we serve a majestic, eternal, transcendent God, we do not know what his sovereign will is. As the Lord says to Israel in Deuteronomy 29, 29, the secret things belong to the Lord our God. So do you know what? I do not think that we should spend a lot of time stressing out over the sovereign will of God. Much of the discussions that I hear going on, or the debates that I hear going on about predestination and the sovereignty of God, are fruitless because the secret things belong to the Lord our God. However, the Bible not only speaks about the sovereign will of God, the Bible speaks about two other aspects of God's will. You see, in Deuteronomy 29, 29, Moses goes on to say this, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of the law. You see, while it's true that God has a sovereign will, a plan that he is working out in human history, he also has a moral will that he's revealed that he wants us to do. So we've looked at God's sovereign will. Now let's have a look at God's moral will. You know, right from the very beginning, God created Adam and Eve in his image. And he told them what he wanted them to do. He wanted them to be fruitful and multiply, to fill the earth and bring all creation under his control. He wanted them to rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing on the earth, displaying to all creation the greatness and glory of God. And God placed them in a garden, and he prepared for them, and he told them that they could eat from any tree in the garden except from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So God gave them a purpose. They were to be his image bearers, and they were to glorify him by reigning and ruling over creation. And God gave them moral boundaries. The law of God was written in their hearts, and he gave them a command. He said, remember I said that you can eat from any tree in the garden except from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So did God have a moral will for their lives? Yes. Not only did he have a sovereign will that they did not know, but he also had a moral will that he had revealed to them. They were to glorify him and live joyfully in the moral boundaries that he had revealed. Now I want you to notice this. What if Adam got up one morning and he turned to God and he said, God, is it your will that I eat an orange this morning? What would have God said to him? Well, I believe that God probably would have said something like this. He would have said, Adam, what have I already told you? You can freely eat from any tree in the garden, except from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Did you pick it off the tree of knowledge of good and evil? No. Well, you can eat it. But what if Adam got up one morning and said, God, is it okay? I've been talking to Eve and we want to have 20 children. What would God have said? Well, God would have said, Adam, I've already told you that you need to go and be fruitful and multiply. So go for it, buddy. You see, my point is this, is God had revealed to Adam his moral will, which included his purpose for living. He was to glorify God and included moral boundaries that he was to live joyfully within. But apart from those things, Adam was free to make choices. God vested Adam with the freedom to make moral choices as long as they were within his moral or revealed boundaries. And you know, I think the same is true for us today. God has vested us with the freedom to make choices as long as they are within his revealed moral will. So should you buy that t-shirt? Or should you buy that car? Or should you eat that meal? Or should you watch that movie? Well, can you glorify God while doing it? Which is your purpose? And does it violate one of God's moral boundaries? You know, you don't have to spend much time stressing over whether God wants you to lie or not, or whether he wants you to cheat, or whether he wants you to get drunk. He's clearly revealed through his moral commands that he doesn't want you to do those things. Now, what about the gray areas of life? We all know that there are clear biblical commands, but in life we are faced with many choices that fall outside of the clear moral commands of the Bible. For example, should you spend all weekend playing PlayStation 4 with your friends? Well, that's an easy one. Should you go out with your non-Christian friends after work to a nightclub? How physical should you get in your relationship with your girlfriend or boyfriend before you're married? How do you make decisions of this nature? These are matters of conscience. And as I've already alluded to, I think that God does give us a measure of freedom. But in matters of conscience, this is where we need to apply biblical wisdom. And for these areas, I think there are three questions that you can ask that I think will help you to make wise decisions. Here's the first question. The first question to ask is, what I'm doing profitable to me? Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable for me. It might be morally okay for you to do such and such a thing, but it may not be profitable for you spiritually. It may not lead you into spiritual health and spiritual growth. You know, last year I was speaking to a good friend of mine, Auntie Marilyn. She's a great friend of mine, a really godly woman. And she was telling me how one night she decided to watch Downton Abbey. And so she watched that really horrible show, Downton Abbey. And the next day she got up and she couldn't stop thinking about Downton Abbey. It just consumed her thoughts. And when she tried to pray that night to the Lord, she was thinking about Downton Abbey. And so what she determined before the Lord is that she wasn't not going to watch Downton Abbey again. Now, is there anything wrong with Downton Abbey? No, there's nothing wrong with it. It's not unlawful to watch Downton Abbey. But what Auntie Marilyn found is that it was unprofitable for her. It didn't lead her into intimacy with Christ. So is what I'm doing profitable for me? Second question. Here's the second question. Will what I do start to control me? Paul goes on to say, all things are lawful for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. You see, things can be morally okay for us to do at the start, but those things can actually lead us into sin and into bondage. This is why if you're dating right now, you have to be very careful with how physical you get before marriage, because you might be doing something right now and it's not unlawful, but it could actually lead you into sin and into bondage. So will what I do start to control me? And the final question, these three questions. So the first question is what I'm doing profitable for me? Is what I do, will it start to control me? And the third question is, will what I do cause someone else to stumble? In other words, will what I do violate the conscience of someone else, leading them away from Christ? You see, as Christians, our life is actually not our own. We belong to Jesus, we live in as a part of our body, and we need to exercise our freedoms in such a way that build up the other members of our body, of the church body. So does God have a moral will for your life? Well, the answer is yes. God's will, you can take this to the bank. God's will for your life is to glorify Him and to live joyfully within the boundaries that He has set. Well, can you miss out on God's moral will for your life? Well, yes. In fact, the Bible says that every single person has missed out on God's moral will for their lives. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God." Every single one of us do not fulfill God's intended purpose for us. We do not glorify Him and we do not live joyfully within His moral commands. But as part of God's sovereign plan, He sent Jesus, the second Adam. And Jesus always lived within the moral will of God. He always glorified God and lived joyfully within His commands. And at the apex of His life, He died on the cross for our sins. And He died to reconcile all things to God, to reverse the curse that had been placed over creation. And He was buried, and 3 days later He rose from the dead and He ascended to the Father's right hand. And one day He is returning to consummate God's kingdom and to fulfill God's plan of setting all things right. But now He offers to all those who will believe in Him and confess Him as their Lord, forgiveness of sins and new life. But if you reject Jesus and go on living as your own Lord, you will miss out. You'll miss out on the joy of knowing God as Father and being part of His kingdom. But if you turn from being your own Lord and confess Jesus as Lord, then God will come into your life and you will be a part of His new creation. So please turn and believe in Jesus tonight. However, even though all of us have violated God's moral will and we all need the restoration and forgiveness found in Jesus, what God is doing right now in your life, if you've believed in Jesus right now, as you sit there and hear His word, what He's doing right now in your life is He's writing God's moral will on your heart through the Holy Spirit. As Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 4 verse 3, it is God's will that we be sanctified. It is God's will that we be increasingly made holy in our characters. Now, we don't do this in our strength. We do this in the strength that the Spirit requires or supplies. But still, you must cooperate with the Holy Spirit, which is why Paul says in Ephesians 5:17, don't be foolish, but understand what the will of God is. And where do you find God's will? You find God's will in God's Word. So get into the Bible. Read the Scriptures every day. And what will happen is as you read the Bible, the Holy Spirit will open up the Bible to you. He'll open up the truth of God's Word to you. He'll put things, he'll press into you in certain ways and show you things that need to change. And the good thing is, He'll not only show you how to change, He'll give you the will and the desire to change. You know, one of the greatest things that impressed me about Pastor Paul is one of the first conversations we had was he said to me these words. Now listen to this, this is so great. He said to me, you know, Timon, I do not think that God, when I appear before God, I don't think that He's gonna ask me, why didn't you do more with your life for me, Paul? I think the main question that He's gonna ask me is, why aren't you more like my son? You see, God's will for your life is to be conformed to the image of Jesus. It's for you to be loving like Jesus. It's for you, no matter what goes on in your life, to have joy and peace like Jesus. It's for you to be patient with the annoying people in your life. It's for you to have self-control like Jesus. But I know what some of you might be thinking right now, okay? Now, some of you might be thinking right now, yes, Timon, that's great that God has a sovereign will for my life. Fantastic. I can see how that can provide comfort, that He's working all things for good. And it's great to know that God has a moral will that He's revealed in His word, that He wants me to glorify Him and He's changing me into the image of Christ. But Timon, I have two choices before me. I have A or B. I can either go to university and do teaching or do nursing. I can either date girl A or date girl B. How do I make a decision? Either option will bring glory to God. How can I make a good decision? Does God care about the decision or path and that he wants me to take? Well, this leads me to the third and probably most controversial part of my talk this evening. The third aspect of God's will. We've talked about God's sovereign will for your life. We've talked about God's moral will for your life. Are you with me? You're still with me? You're there? You're on the edge of your seats, right? That's good. Here's the third aspect of God's will for your life is what I call God's personal will for your life. And I've spent a lot of time this week thinking about this and mulling over this. I probably spent 30 hours on this sermon thinking about it because I wanted to not lead you astray, but give you good, solid direction. And so I do think that there is this thing where that God does have a personal will for your life. And now, it's not probably the best word that I could choose, but at this moment, I don't have a better word, so I'm going to use that word, all right? I don't think it's in the same category as God's sovereign will and God's moral will, but I do think that it's good to talk about God's personal will. Now, in defining what I mean by God's personal will for your life, I want to first define what I don't mean, okay? So let me tell you what I don't mean. When I speak about God's personal will for your life, I'm not saying that God has mapped out a specific plan for your life that he wants you to discover before you do anything. You know, some Christians view God's will this way. They think that God's got this specific ideal plan for how I should live each day, from what I should eat to what I should wear to where I should go. And they think my job is to figure out his plan before I do anything so that I can stay in the, and you've heard this term, the center of his will. Have you heard that term before? However, I think that this type of thinking leads to passivity. It leads to stressing out over these options before me, wondering whether I've going to make a bad choice and therefore step out of the center of God's will. So what do I mean when I say God's personal will for your life? What I mean is this. I've spent a lot of time thinking about this. So this is my current thinking. Here it is. I think that God, as your loving Father, does have desires for how he wants you to use the one life that he's given you. As any loving father, God has desires for how he wants you to use the one life that he's given you. Firstly, he wants you to come to him and begin a personal relationship with him. Peter says, God desires that none should perish, but all should come to him. Second, as I've already said, he desires you to grow in that relationship with him. He desires every person here to have a sweet, intimate walk with him as Father. Isn't that what you want? A sweet, deep, intimate, loving walk with God your Father. But finally, I do believe that God has desires for how he wants to use your life. I do believe that God has given you talents. He's given you gifts. He's shaped your life. He's given you abilities, and he's given it all for a purpose. I do believe that he wants to use your one life to make an impact for him, to make a difference for him. As Jesus said in John 15, if you abide in me, you will do what? You will bear much fruit. And if you bear much fruit, you will glorify my Father and so prove to be my disciple. God has been shaping your life, and he desires to use you for his glory. And the way he has shaped you is different from the way he shaped me. The specific calling that God has placed on my life is different from the calling that he's placed on your life. You know, when I look at the Bible, there is no doubt that God uses different people in different ways. God used Joseph to be this ruler over Egypt and save Egypt from starvation. God used Moses to deliver God's people out of slavery. And God used Jesus to be the sin substitute for the world. The Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 1 verse 1 that he was an apostle by the will of God. So he saw his life's work as that of being an apostle. That was God's calling on his life personally. It wasn't God's will for everyone to be an apostle, but it was God's will for the Apostle Paul to be an apostle. And I think it's not just biblical characters, but it's the same for every one of us. that God has created you for a purpose. He has a calling for your life. He wants to use your one life to make a difference for Him in the world. So does God have a personal will for your life? I think the answer is yes. Your Heavenly Father desires you to come to Him, to grow in a love relationship with Him. And then He wants you to surrender that life to Him every day so that you can be used by Him to glorify Him where He's placed you. Well, here's the big question. Can you miss out on God's personal will for your life? Yes, you can. Some people will miss out. They will fail to come to God. And God, in the end, will judge them and He will send them to the worst fate imaginable in hell. God takes no pleasure in the destruction of the wicked, it says. But if you don't want to come to Him, He will let you go your own way. And if you have come to Him, if you fail to abide in Him, if you fail to pursue Him, now I'm not saying that you have to be perfect to be used by Him. I'm not perfect. I'm talking about abiding in Christ, maintaining that love relationship with God. When you fail, coming back and confessing and walking with God daily. If you don't do that, you won't be used by Him. And there are many Christians who aren't being used by God, who aren't bearing fruit because they aren't abiding in Christ. And I also believe that churches can miss God's will for them. Certainly the churches of Ephesus and Laodicea, they had lost their first love and become lukewarm. And Jesus had threatened that He would take away their lampstand and spit them out of His mouth. Now I believe that, now here's the good news. Here's the good news. Is that God is a God of second chances, third chances, fourth chances, and even more. And if you come back to Him tonight in 2017 and say, God, I surrender my life to You. Please use me. I'm sorry for walking away from You. I'm sorry for not abiding You, for being disobedient. He will receive you back. He will take you back. And He can restore the years that the locusts have eaten, the Bible says. So it's never too late to come to Him. And there is this tension in Scripture. There is this tension because most of the time, God wants us to make wise decisions based upon biblical wisdom. But sometimes He does give us specific subjective direction. For example, in the life of the Apostle Paul, right at the beginning of his missionary career, in Acts 13, the Holy Spirit said to the community, "Set aside Paul and Barnabas for the ministry to which I've called them." So God gave them specific direction right there. But notice this, after God gave this specific direction, what did Paul and Barnabas do next? They got on a boat to Cyprus. How did they know to do that? Well, we're not told, but what I think happened is that they took this specific direction from God and they used their wisdom and they made plans. You see, all throughout Paul's letters, we see him making plans. So God does sometimes give us specific direction. I'm not against that. He gives us subjective, specific direction. But most of the time, He wants us to make wise decisions. So, are you with me still? All right. Is this good? Give me something. Good. That just encourages me. So what do you do when you have two options before you? A or B? How do you decide between these two options? Well, this week I was thinking about my life and how I've made decisions in the past and how God's guided me. You see, 8 years ago, I had a similar thing happen to me. I had two options before me. I could either stay at Subiaco Church in Perth and continue being the associate pastor of worship, or I could take the position of senior pastor at Oakden Baptist Church. And both options were obviously good options. Both options would bring glory to God. Now, obviously, I chose to become the senior pastor of Oakden because I'm here tonight. But how did I make this decision? Well, I do believe that God did give me specific subjective direction to become the senior pastor of Oakden. But I have to tell you that I also walked the pathway of wisdom. And I just want to share with you the steps that I took. So maybe you can actually, if you need to make a decision, you could walk these same steps. First, over the course of my life, God had given me a passion for preaching and a passion for leadership. So when the opportunity came up to be the senior pastor of Oakden, God had already formed in me a great desire to preach and to lead. And you know, as I said before, God has already given us certain gifts and abilities. So as you look at the options before you, you need to ask yourself, how has God providentially shaped my life? What are my natural abilities and passions? And is the option before me in line with those abilities, giftings, and passions? You see, if you hate children, it's probably a pretty bad idea to become a school teacher. Or if you can't stand the sight of blood, then don't become a nurse. Second, God sovereignly opened the door for the opportunity. I was in Adelaide in 2008, and I saw advertised on ACM's website the role for the senior pastor, and I decided to send them my resume. Les Crawford quickly sent me back an email saying that the elders were interested. So God sovereignly opened up the opportunity. You know, there is no good, it's no good in thinking that you're going to do teaching at university if no university offers you a position. Or there is no good asking that girl out on a date if she's already married. You can only take advantage of the sovereign opportunities that are placed before you. Now, please do not use this as an excuse for laziness. You might say, well, I put my resume on seek.com and no employer has come calling. So maybe God wants me to live off my parents and just play Xbox all day. No, he does not. Get out of the house, knock on the doors, and get a job. Further, sometimes some doors are really, really shut closed and have to be pressed open a lot. So just because at first you get a knockback, don't say that that's it. You may have to keep on knocking. Third, I committed the decision to much prayer. I sought the Lord in prayer, asking for his wisdom. Psalm 37 verse 5 says, commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act. Fourth, I used my brain. I know it's a novel thing, but I used my brain. I investigated the possibility. I came on a trip over to Adelaide and had a list of questions for the elders. I also had a list of questions of what it would be like living in Adelaide for my wife and my family. My dad used to say, often to me, he used to say, Timon, if God has given you a brain, he intends for you to use it. Now, I wonder why he said that to me, but he used to say that often. Fifth, I consulted the counsel of wise, godly people. Proverbs 15:22 says, without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors, they succeed. So I went to my mentor, Pastor Graham, and asked him about it and asked his advice and sought his wisdom. And finally, as I said, I also experienced the subjective leading of the Holy Spirit. On one of my visits I made to the church, at the end of the visit, when I drove to the airport, Pastor Paul drove me to the airport and he put his hand on my shoulder and he said, Timon, I believe that you are God's man for our church. And I have to say that I sensed in my heart that it seemed right. I had this real sense of peace that God was in fact leading us to Adelaide. Now, while I had that peace, Tegan did not have that peace. I actually came back from that same trip, got off the plane, and the first thing that Tegan said to me was this. She says, I don't want to hear about it. I've just had a baby, and I can't deal with the thought of moving to Adelaide. So I just completely backed off. But a few weeks later, she was sitting in a church gathering, and the speaker was talking about how we need to be willing to go wherever God is sending us. And at the end of that meeting, we sang this song, I will go where you send me. Jesus, take me, now I am yours. And Tegan said that as she sang that song right there in front of her, a person got up with an I Love Adelaide t-shirt on. And she said in her heart, well, you might love Adelaide, but I don't. And then she went back to singing that song, I will go where you send me. Jesus, take me, now I am yours. And she sensed God was speaking to her by his word, through his spirit, in the gathering of God's people, that she needed to go where God was sending us. So God did lead us subjectively. And so because of all of these things, the passions that God had given me, the opportunity that God had made available, the peace I felt in prayer, the investigations I had made, the counsel of godly people, and the subjective leading of the Holy Spirit, I became convinced that I should accept the position of the senior pastor of Oakden Baptist Church. Now, was I 100% certain that this was the right decision? Well, I have to be honest and say, no, I wasn't. You see, some of the people that had spoken to me had said, you don't want to be the guy who follows the guy who's been there for 36 years. See, if you don't know this, Pastor Paul was the previous pastor at our church. Paul, just stand up and just wave so people can see you. This is Pastor Paul right here. We love Pastor Paul. Pastor Paul had been here for 36 years, and people, the general wisdom is you don't want to follow that guy because you're just going to last 1 year. One year. People are going to get sick of you. They're going to kick you out. So was I 100% certain that it was a good decision, that it was the best decision? No, I was not. But that's where faith comes in, my friends. You see, I think that some of the reason why we want this detailed plan, some of the reason we chuck out fleeces, is we're not willing to trust God. We're not willing to have faith. And God wants us to walk by faith and not by sight. He wants us to walk trusting in Him. Further, I said to myself, you know, if I only last 1 year at Oakden and people do get upset with me and they kick me out, then that's okay. You know, my life is not my own. God doesn't always lead us into success. Sometimes He leads us into difficulty to glorify Him. And so I thought to myself, if God wants to do that with my life, that's okay. Because He's the sovereign God. So knowledge of His sovereign will provided me the courage to step out and do what I believed He was leading me to do. Now, what if you seek to make a wise decision and you go through all the steps that I just outlined and it still doesn't seem clear? What if both options appeal to your passions, both doors are opened, you feel no peace about either option in prayer, your counselors are divided, and you don't get an I Love Adelaide t-shirt? What do you do then? Well, it may be that God does want you to wait on Him some more for direction. But if you have to make a decision, then here's some novel advice. Make a decision. Make a decision. You see, if it doesn't turn out to be ideal, don't worry. God is still sovereignly in control of your life. He can be trusted. He has promised to work all things out for good. You should do what Proverbs 3 verse 5 says. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will tell you exactly what His plans for you are. Is that what the verse says? We misquote that verse. It says, He will make your path straight. As you walk, He will straighten the path before you. You know, as I close right now, some of you have big decisions to make. Some of you might have to make big decisions about your future or big decisions about a relationship or something else. And I hope what I've said has been helpful to you. I hope that knowing that God has a sovereign will has provided you not with confusion, but with comfort that He is in control. I hope that knowing that God has a moral will has provided you with direction, that I am to live out under the Spirit and become like Christ. And I hope that God, having a personal will for your life, has inspired you, that He wants to know you. He wants to grow in a love relationship with you, and He wants to use you. You know, I started out tonight with a story about how I was going to get into music, but I got into kindergarten teaching. And when I got that news of getting into kindergarten teaching, my mum turned to me and she said, well, Timon, you're going to do that kindergarten teaching. So she sent me to university to do kindergarten teaching. Now, it wasn't all bad. I mean, in the class, the kindergarten teaching class, there was me and 300 girls. So there was some advantages to it. But nevertheless, while I was feeling like I had missed out, little did I know that that was part of God's plan to get me to a point where I was humbled before Him. I was such a proud church kid, and I needed to be humble before God so that I could experience the glory of Christ. And I wonder, maybe tonight you think that you have missed out Maybe life hasn't gone the way that you had planned, but maybe it's been all part of God's plan to get you to this moment, right here, 2017. So you'll see the greatness and glory of King Jesus, and you'll surrender your life to him. It's no better thing that you could do in this moment if you want direction and say, God, I give you my life. I give you my life. You know, often, I want you to know this. God doesn't tell you something for your consideration. God tells you so that you will obey him. So why don't you surrender your life to him afresh tonight? Why don't you come to him and say, Lord, I give you my life. Heavenly Father, you are a good father, and I want to come to you. I want to walk in a relationship, a close relationship with you, and I want to be used by you.